Have you ever worked in, there's a add-on extension from which,
okay. So maybe we should get started?
I'll try and close the door now. But experience from before was that it got a bit stuffy, so I may have to open it again.
Okay.
So welcome to this session on library services and what you can expect to get out of the library. My name is Hege Folkestad, as Karin said. I'm a subject specialist at the Science Library. Being a subject specialist means that I'm not trained in library science. My main training is from one of the topics that I cover as a subject specialist. I cover marine biosciences and molecular biology, and I'm trained in marine biology. So I have my master's and my PhD doing marine biology. So I do think I have a fair idea of what you guys are up for. I'll be talking about available databases. I'll be talking about efficient searching, about how to locate articles, and a bit towards the end about citing correctly. If you feel at any point that you don't quite get what I'm saying, or you think that there's something I'm skipping, or that you would like to know, then don't hesitate to interrupt me, because then we can slow down and take it from there. So I'll be using the PowerPoint a bit, but I'll also go into showing you the database, showing you more of the databases in actual searches from a web browser. If those of you have access to any kind of computer or tablet, some kind of things to search on, please take them out. There will be a couple of exercises. If you don't have access to anything like that, then maybe the person you're sitting next to does. So you try and look. Since we're not today actually in the library, I feel like saying a few things about the library in which I work every day. So this is the entrance to the library. You find the library up at the Johannes Brunsgata, downstairs, more or less, from the physics building or the Realfagbygget. And we offer a lot of different services. First of all, everything that you need access to electronic. It might be books, dictionaries, encyclopedias, research papers that we pay for, that we pay for a license for you to access. Then you should make sure you get 24/7 access to that. I'll explain to you later an easy way of getting that access. But the main point is that anything that's behind a paywall that the university library pays for, you should have access to. Then, of course, there still are printed books. There still are journals where the contents either is not available electronically or where we do not have access to it electronically. There are dictionaries, papers, and so on that you do need to physically go to the library to access. We now have open 6 days per week. It says here 9:30, but it's 8:30. Until 7 o'clock. Saturdays we're open between 10 and 4. And we have, in addition to, if you feel like a change from working down here, we do have workspaces, with or without computers. We have places where you can work individually or in groups. Of course, we also offer qualified assistance, not just on the actual searching and figuring out the databases, but also me, myself, and Ola Voss are two subject specialists that cover biology. I'm being the marine biologist and more zoologist. He is a mycologist. I know the botany well. And we share things like evolution or conservation, that kind of things. So it's possible to drop in, but either of us may be out at the exact moment you're coming. So if you have specialized questions, it might be okay to drop us an email and set up an appointment. It's possible to go through our web pages and request a librarian, in which case we'll set up an appointment like that. We do also offer a site license to EndNote, meaning that everyone connected to the university should have full access to downloading EndNote, the full EndNote version. Then we offer a subject page, that's a particular page for biology. We offer a chat service with resources, with links and resources particularly relevant to biology. We have a chat service, we have a Facebook page where we announce things like open EndNote classes and so on. So if you feel like following us, then that is one place where you can find that kind of information. Of course, we do offer more, but these are some of the key things that we offer. Now, how do you access our electronic library? Well, here's our webpage, uib.nou.ub, and you can over here, sort of, you can switch between English and Norwegian. This is the English language version. We have this central search box, and this start page we suggest that you use as a starting page for searching for information for two reasons. First of all, it offers an integrated search where you immediately can see which books we own or don't own, or which articles you immediately have access to or not. But secondly, in this, from this page, you will, if you allow your web browser to, get a cookie that sits there, does nothing until you try to access a resource that's behind a paywall. And if that paywall is something the university library pays for you to have access to, then there's a logon window that will pop up. And this logon window will let you identify as a user from University of Bergen by logging on with your regular user ID and password. And once you're behind that, you should have access to everything that you have access to on campus. Everything that we pay for you to have access to. I will instead, let's see, one page more here, because I wanted to start you off immediately with a search from that search box. So if you can all go to that web page and to that search box and imagine, I know that at this point it's likely that you haven't all decided on a project for your master's thesis. If you have, feel free to exchange this suggestion with something that's relevant to your own topic. But if you don't have anything yet, here's a suggestion from me. Imagine you're writing a following term paper, the three-spined sticklebass, Gastrostis aculeatus, as a model organism, strengths and weaknesses. And I will use this example to show you how I break down a search and how I try to figure out how to go about from a project to something that I search for. So if you can all just enter a search into this interface, and we take 5 minutes, and do ask if you have any questions.
Question about EndNote. Where do you need to be working on access to EndNote?
I have a web address for you to download it, but I don't have it in my hand. What you can do is you can drop me an email and I can send it to you. Other than that, we will be offering EndNote classes throughout the fall. Have you used EndNote already?
No.
You will send it differently on Microsoft.
Just search on UIB or EndNote and
It's true. It routes you through the whole thing.
Yeah,
that's the useful thing. Yeah. I have a direct link, but you know, you might just as well just search it.
Yeah.
Oh.
The library account.
No, I did it differently. I have what's called a VPN.
Okay.
Which is a different way of doing it.
Yeah, because if you want to go to a proxy server, in this case, you just choose which library. This should be down at the bottom. Then it's a regular user ID, and that's the same thing as you have for your email.
By using this environment.
Okay. So, did you have any questions? Anything trouble arising? Yep.
You get 17,900 articles.
Yep.
But how do you narrow the search?
So that's a very good point. I'm getting to some of that in a minute, but that's part of the trouble of searching either this one or Google Scholar. The trouble isn't what it used to be when I started my master's thesis, which was to find enough about the topic. But the problem is to just screen out everything that's not immediately relevant to you. And we have a lot of tools. So if you look at this web page here, I have a lot of different options. There is an advanced search that can help me, but the whole thing here is based on, rather than spending a lot of time on the searching in advance, you use all the filtering options over here to narrow down to what you find relevant. So I'd like to, let's see, because this gets in the way. Okay, so let me just say a little bit about what this search does. First of all, by default, if you compare this to a search in, say, Google Scholar, it's already screened it, so everything it shows to you should be available for now, either physically in the library or electronically online. So that's what it's showing you in the first place. You won't always be happy with that, right? Sometimes you need to get out of the library's media collection. You can do that in two ways. You can either look here in all libraries where you will find out what's available through other libraries in Norway. So any book, for instance, might be situated in, say, University of Trondheim, University of Oslo. You can order it. But you'll find out here where it's situated, and you get a chance to order, in this case, a photocopy, or you can order a book for a loan. But you can also expand it outside of the Norwegian cooperation at all by ticking off this box, and it will expand it to anything that matches your search. Then there's another way of limiting. You can look at resource type. And now it shows you articles, dissertations, newspaper articles, reviews down here. And already out here, you can see here's a reference entry. The next one is a dissertation. And the third one is an article. Well, when I want to limit it, I have more options here. And what I can start by is include articles. Or in this particular case, when you're to a new topic, it might be good by looking at reference works such as dictionaries to make sure that you compare, you can compare definitions from 1, 2, 3 different entries and see if you have a fair understanding of the topics or the concepts you're working with. And then you can also look at encyclopedias to get a sort of little sneak peek into what is happening in that area. What is the basic knowledge in that area? And also, sometimes you need to look into spin-off areas that are not at the core of what you're studying, but you may need to get more information about that. Then, looking at just the reference entries may be quite useful. In this case now, I'm limiting to reference entries just to show you what type of material you get. And here you will find a reference entry from Dictionary of Zoology. This one too seems to be the same. Then you have another reference entry. This one might be, say, from either Wikipedia or Encyclopedia Britannica. There are more references here. Sometimes you will find just the article, and sometimes you will find the full dictionary, and then you will have to open the dictionary and search from there. Now, that is as you're starting up a new project, that might be useful. But these may not be citable references. So 90% of what you want to cite later on might be, will end up being, scientific papers that are published in journals, right? So what you would like to do then is, instead of limiting as I did by reference entries, you can go and limit it by articles. And then also, here's a chance to say I only want peer-reviewed journals. And how many of you are familiar with the term peer review? Yeah, you've probably been talking about it in the classes before. But basically, it means that before any paper is published, it's sent through a committee. You know, they never meet, but a selection of 2 or 3, typically, experts in the very field that you're covering. That will scrutinize your paper, look through it, look at whether your methods are suitable to address the question you're raising, whether your results or whether your conclusions are soundly based on the results you have, whether you've used the appropriate statistical methods, and whether you cited the appropriate literature in the process. So from there on, if it passes the peer review, then it will be published. And in this case, it's possible to limit to just peer-reviewed journals, which I just did. But again, I still have loads and loads and loads of results. And one of the troubles with this is that you do tend to get many more references here than you can possibly go through. And that's why it's wise to move on and think about more advanced searching. So, how do you make sure that you find updated, relevant, and trustworthy literature? So you screen it appropriately. And that you find all the articles that are relevant, but nothing that ends up being just what we could call noise, things that aren't really relevant, things that just get in the way and steal your time. And some of the answers to that is by making sure you search control databases. Databases where there's a screening on what goes into these databases, for instance. So, how many of you have tried to search Google Scholar? Do you use regular Google for article searches? Sometimes? Yeah, yeah. And those of you who do it seem to say, well, yeah, I do, but sometimes you may have experienced that there are problems with it, but that's why you sort of waved a bit. Yeah. Hmm. And what would you say that the main problems would be? Any
non-relevant articles?
Yeah. A lot of it. Yeah. That might sometimes be a problem with Google Scholar too. I'm getting to that in a minute with where I have a comparison of different types of databases. But if you go to quality control sources or databases where there's a screening of which types of articles can enter that database, then there's a quality control prior to your search. That means that what you're getting should be already quality. Now, it may not still be relevant exactly to you and to what you're looking at. That will be your judgment. But it is a big help. The next thing you can do is you can check whether the paper is cited or downloaded or discussed. If you go to a journal like PLOS Biology, then you can follow that paper and see how often has that been downloaded? Has it created any discussion? Has anyone shared it on Twitter? Or has anyone blogged about it? What kind of, is there any direct responses? Has anyone discussed the methods or said anything about its appropriateness? So all of these will be a help to figure out whether a particular paper is any good. But I think my main advice would be to say that start by focusing on relevance. Limit the number of things you look at. Limit the list of papers you will have to look at as much as you possibly can, so you make sure that that list is not too time-consuming, right? And once you're in there, the best and most important filter is the one you should install between your ears, because you do need to make a judgment eventually of the papers you read yourself. If you take advantage of the search options that databases have, so that you limit it to something that's handleable. You know, if you have a list of 50 papers you should have a look at, then you can screen those manually. If you have 3,000, then there's no chance you can screen that list manually, right? And figure out which ones are good or not. So have the machines or the computers do the initial screening, but ultimately you have to send it through your own filter as well. Now, okay, fine, that took me to the next page. I need to remember to not touch the screen, so it sends me off. Okay, so what I've done here, I've looked at some features of databases, such as coverage, how much it covers, whether it's peer-reviewed or not, whether it allows complex searching, whether it allows filtering, whether it contains material such as e-books, reports, and so on, whether it contains citation counts, or whether it allows you to export into EndNote. And then I have different types of databases. So the system that the university library uses is called Oria. So it doesn't say Oria so much when you enter from our search box, but once you're in the system, it says Oria on top. And Oria, like Google Scholar, has a very wide coverage. Both of them get data from all the major publishers. Also, what Oria does gets, in addition, is data from what we call our catalog, which is you know, basically a list of everything that the University of Bergen owns and subscribes to. If you look at other types of databases, you have journal archives. Journal archives are databases by publishers. So that, for instance, you have Science Direct, you have Springer Link, you have Oxford journals, and so on. These all offer pretty good databases for search. And also, they contain generally the PDF within the same platform. However, there's a problem with that. If you think that you have one particular journal that you want to have a look at, then where would you find the competing journal? Not with the same publisher, because that's not the very good business model, right? You don't want to compete with yourself. So basically, that means that if you want to make sure that you look at all the different journals that deal with behavioral ecology, for instance, then you need to look across different platforms and look at different databases. So although these journal archives tend to be very good, have very good options, it still means that if you're looking at those, then you need to look at all of those, right? Rather than just one. So there's another option, and that's what we call abstract databases, or indices, or bibliographical databases. And instead of the journal archives that looks at everything that's published within one company, instead it looks at particularly everything that's been published on a particular subject across all the different publishers, right? So that's typically by subject. One major exception from that is ISI Web of Science, which covers both the natural sciences, medicine, humanities, and social sciences. Now, they have a different way of limiting what's in their database, and they look at how frequently journals in their database are cited. So they contain only highly cited journals, right? Now, if we look at other features, such as peer review, you'll find that Aurea contains peer-reviewed material, but not everything in it is peer-reviewed. However, you may use the filter to take away the things that aren't peer-reviewed. So even though initially it doesn't contain just peer-reviewed material, you can limit to just the peer-reviewed. Google Scholar contains peer-reviewed and not peer-reviewed material, meaning that you will have to screen it in some other way to make sure you get to the peer-reviewed material. The journal archives, again, mainly contain peer-reviewed, but can also contain things that aren't. And then again, depending on which index you're looking at, indices such as ISI Web of Science typically almost exclusively contain peer-reviewed material. They may have a couple of editorials as well from some of the journals, but they don't add any other types of material. Then, how good is the database at offering you options of complex searching that might help you to figure out the easiest way to catch everything you're interested in and screen out everything you want? Aurea and Google Scholar allows a certain level of complex searching, but it's quite tricky. Whereas the journal archives and the indices are set up in such a way that they invite you to do pretty complex searching, and it makes that very easy for you. Then there's the filtering. Remember where I screened in the left margin and used that to filter out material that were only articles or only peer-reviewed, things like that. You can also use it with authors to limit to authors. Aurea is based on that kind of thinking. Most journal archives I'm aware of have that, and also the indices. But Google Scholar made some attempts and they weren't successful. They still maintain a couple of filters and those don't work. That's my experience. So don't trust them for that one. Then, if you want to find things like ebooks, reports, and that kind of thing, then typically you won't find that in indices. So some journal archives may contain chapters or ebooks. And then, if you really want to find out, you may want to go instead to Oria or Google Scholar. When it comes to citation counts, then really there are just two sources I would trust that. That's Google Scholar, and that's the ISI Web of Science. These contain counts of how many times a particular article has been cited. And then the last question is, how well are they adapted to let you export to EndNote? Oria, very good. Well, you know, most of them are really good, but Google Scholar has one problem. It is that you cannot export more than one reference at a time. Now, I know that EndNote has recently had, finally had their iPad version out, their application for iPad and I think Androids as well. I don't know if they've solved the problem, but if not, then if you have a list of 20 references, you need to sit and feed it one by one. It's pretty tedious. It's very annoying. But the main take-home message is that there isn't one type of reference or database, or there isn't one database that will do everything for you. So depending on what your question is, and depending on what task you're working on, you may have to go to different databases. If what you want is to create a really good search by topic and figure out what's out there, then maybe going to an index is very good. Then again, if you know that you have to find a particular report or a particular ebook, then Oria or Google Scholar may be a better option for finding those references. So next, okay, if we think back to the example term paper, three spine sticklebacks as model organisms, what are their strengths and weaknesses? Of course you can enter all of those words into Google and see what Google does. However, that depends on anyone actually having written that paper already, which some may. Well, you know, I happen to know that some have, but not a lot of people. But instead, you may want to break down the question and first of all say, which traits make for a good or a bad model organism? And this is the point where I would like to ask you. Any suggestions? What makes a good model organism?
Homogeneity.
Homogeneity, yeah. And you mean it should...
Genetically homogeneous.
Yeah.
So you can replicate results and not have too much variance in the results.
Yeah, for instance, if you're looking at behavior. On the other hand, if you want to make a natural selection or a selection experiment, then, and they're all homogenous. Yeah. Lifespan? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So again, depending on your particular issue, it might be good that they're either homogenous or not. But you said lifespan? Others?
Cheap to rare.
Cheap to rare. Others? Well, you know, it would be an advantage if they weren't exactly red-listed. Anything else? Elephants? Well, size matters. Yeah. And then the next question is, of course, to say, okay, which of these traits do the sticklebacks have? Right? Hardiness would be bad, right? So so they can take a little bit of handling. What I did here was to just break down. I have some topics over here, several topics such as model organism. You want to look at time span, abundance, lab friendliness, you know, relevance to the particular question you want to raise, and a previous understanding of the system. And what you would like to search for, I've sort of put down some search words that you could enter into a database to make a search, but then you need to also think, are there any synonyms? Are there any other terms in use for the same phenomenon? Either that's completely overlapping or nearly overlapping. Are there any related terms? If you're looking at high tide, you are obviously in some sense also interested in low tide or tidal variation, right? But there are different words that you can enter to get related terms. So in this case, for instance, longevity, we know that might be interchangeable with lifespan, but once you're looking at longevity and lifespan, you may also be interested in the generation time, because you know some animals are semilparous, breed once. Some spread out their breeding so they can breed for a long, extended period. You know. So then the question of what is the average generation time, or what is the minimum possible generation time, might be interesting. And the abundance, you know, if you can't actually rear them in the lab, then maybe you're left with the other option, which is collective. And then you need to know, okay, fine, but do they behave weird when you take them into the lab? If it's a novel environment, can you trust that their behavior in the lab is the same as in the field? Probably not. And so on. And then, of course, once you have figured out some of these words, it's useful to sit down with each and every word you find out for your topic and figure out, are there any relevant other terms you should also be looking at once you're looking at that. And this is a process where you don't just search and then you're done. But having searched, you will sometimes notice that, oh, okay, here's another keyword that usually appears with this one. So you look at that again, and you go back and you do more searches with a new term. So here's how you can combine this. A bit further, pretty much the same topic. Okay, so when you carry out searches, it's very useful to think in terms of Venn diagrams. So here you can see, here's model organism, and here's gastrostus. And you see, you may initially be interested in everything that has to do with model organism or basics of model organisms, but you may also want to look specifically at what types of studies have gastrostus been used as a model organism for. So here's the overlap. So when I carry out a search and enter these terms with and between them, then I look at only the intersection here. And what you need to understand when you carry out searches in Google or Google Scholar is that even though you don't put in an and, that's what they assume. If you keep listing several terms, they will only look for the terms, for cases where there are overlap between all the different sets of words. Yeah. So every time you add another term in a Google search, you narrow it down, you know? But every time, if you narrow it down by a term that is unlikely to get you anything, that too can take away things that are relevant for you. So again, abundance and gastrostus, or rearing and gastrostus. However, here's one. Okay, let's say I'm interested in either longevity or in generation time. Right? So, what happens? Okay. Longevity or generation time. Here I entered terms with the word and between them. That's what we call a Boolean search term and. That gives you the intersection. Now, longevity or generation times give you sums up what's in both of them, right? But in this particular case, I've afterwards added and gastrostis. So now it has this lobe-shaped intersection here, which is that it either contains something or on longevity or something on generation time, but always in combination with gastrostis. Now, when do you use and when do you use or? And is used for narrowing down, or is used for expanding. And specifically, you use it if you have synonyms or near synonyms, related terms, where you're concerned that you will get everything published in a particular field. But they're not terribly useful on their own because they tend to just give you long, long, long lists of references. But when you use them to combine with another term, to say, you know, I'm not interested in everything on longevity or generation time, only when it appears with gastrostis aculeatus. And one more list of tools to use when you're searching. When you search, you can use what we call wildcards. These are little signs or symbols. In this case, it's an asterisk, and this is almost universal in databases. This symbol can substitute several characters. Typically, it doesn't specify how many characters it substitutes. So if I write behavior and then the asterisk, that covers actually both behavior and behavioral, right? So these are not synonyms, but they're related terms. Just that predators, predatory, predation are related terms that I might all be interested in if I'm looking at predator-prey relationships. Then in some databases, there's a problem when you have access to British and American spelling and, you know, British papers, American published papers. So in this case, for instance, I specified that the last letter should be R. So I'm basically looking at behavior, British spelling, American spelling. But by masking this second letter here, the way I put it in here means that, you know, there could be a U, there doesn't have to be a U. That's how it reads. So that means that it will return to me anything that contains British or American spelling. Similarly, we're now in Norway. A lot of Norwegians have weird characters in their names. So let's say you're searching for a researcher. I have to choose one from bio department, Voxøy. If I substitute the Ø with an asterisk, then I'm safe. Now, the letter A, for instance, could sometimes be transcribed as A, A, sometimes as E, E, or sometimes as AE, AE. And figuring out that, you know, if you look at just one single database, I've experienced cases where all three have been used in the same database, right? So even though a single database may have rules for how to transcribe it, it may not be consistent. But instead, if you just try and mask that letter, it makes it a whole lot easier. And then I was talking about combinations. Using and, or not. So and narrows and specifies searches, or widened searches and can typically be used between synonyms or near synonyms. Examples here are happiness or joy, which are sort of near synonyms, happiness and chocolate. Here you're looking at the overlap. And you can use parentheses to specify the sequence of searches. So if I want to have a look at either happiness or joy, but only as it's caused by chocolate, right? So then I specify happiness or joy within a parenthesis, and then and chocolate in the second parenthesis. So it works the same way as mathematics. You work your way out of a parenthesis. So it solves within the parenthesis first. Yeah. Any questions? Okay, I'll skip this now. I have a second exercise, but I think I'll just show something first. Okay, so here's our webpage at the University Library. So you can see here that this is a bit counterintuitive in my mind, but I can click the Science Library and get the hours for the Science Library and address for the Science Library here. However, a more useful function is to, from here, look at my subject, Sciences. And I can choose biology. And what we have here are some of the library services we've thought useful for those of you who study biology. So I can look at books and book searches. I can look at reference books. Here are tips for academic writing. Here's something on EndNote. You can go from there and find information about how to download EndNote and so on. But in this case, I'd go to articles. And if I skip the what's written here, I also have a list of databases that are relevant to biology. There's ASFA, Aquatic Sciences and Fisheries Abstracts. That covers everything that has to do with anything aquatic. Any of you who does any aquatic stuff, I strongly recommend you to have a look. Then there's BIOSIS Previews. JSTOR is a journal database, and you know it's worth searching, but you will generally find things from JSTOR either in ASFA or BIOSIS or the others. There's also entomology abstracts. Anyone working with insects. There's very highly specialized databases here called Helminthological Abstracts and Review of Plant Pathology. Then there's PubMed that covers biomedicine, medicine, veterinary medicine, anything that has to do with molecular stuff, physiology, so on. Then there's Web of Science that covers all different topics, and then there's zoological records for any of you who are zoologists. And those of you who work with taxonomy, zoological records, if you do zoology or biosis previews, have a lot of taxonomic data. So that might be quite useful. Now I'm going to give you an exercise, and you can go either from here and look at one of those databases, or in the PowerPoint I've listed another way of finding it. You press this function here, that's called Find Databases. What you're doing now is you're not searching for a reference, you're searching for a database in which to then search for a reference. So but if you search for a database, you can't search for Gastrostus because there's no particular database called Gastrostus. However, you can search for biology, and it will give you the databases that cover biology. And again, you can either use this or a question of your own. something that's relevant to the research you want to do. So if you find a database, carry out researches based on the principles that I've just described to you. Take 15 minutes and we'll resume from there. Okay, so it's now, yeah, 10 past. So 25, let's start after that. Well, you know, half past, we say, like a 5 minutes break. I'll open the door, so we get some air. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask.
The thing I learned a lot was
do you have to download Zotero?
Yeah, you have an extension on Chrome, and then you have to make the user.
Det går an på en desktop-gav när du kommer till full masteruppgave. Då säger det sånt att Jeg brukte det på en sånn treningsakker hele veien, siden jeg brukte på master, men det var ikke noe vanlig den gangen. Og da, han som delte kontorene, som gjorde det mange, det gjorde jeg ikke. Jeg brukte det på en sånn.
Ja,
altså noe
av det
verste
var
å skrive ned kilder. Ja, men da er sorter og suveren, den tar det fra ikke. Den tar det fra Orion, den tar det fra Google Scholar, den tar det fra Web of Science, hva som helst.
Ja, så det er så galt å gå for å få opptrepp til det.
Veldig galt. Ja, jeg vet ikke om vi gjør det. Jeg vet ikke om vi gjør det. Ja, men ja, så du var inne på oss da.
Abstracts or ISLs because they allow very detailed searching.
I'd like you right. Yeah. And now it's George Blake.
This is going to be just an example.
So, all your search of JSTOR and that's like other ones like IMCB, I think it's called.
Yeah.
It's like you have to search each of those one by one on your own website.
Yeah.
So it's really just frustrating.
Yes, and they tend to have really good search engines. They tend to have very smooth
transfers.
And you know exactly which strategy you're going for. You know exactly which article you're looking for when you go there. And the articles available in the same database, it's very smooth. However, there is that exact problem that they're not overlapping. And if you want to have a look at,
it takes like 5 to 10 minutes when we use search for stuff, because you have like abstract titles and other stuff. So just like, if you do it in like 4 different areas, it's just like a lot of time to get like zero efficiency.
But also, it's possible once you set up a search and you're happy with the search, what can set to improve is that you save that search from the database. That might be a good thing. You can save that search and have it sent to you either as an RSS feed or as an email. So you'll be notified like once per month if there is anything new in that search. Since last time, here's 5 new papers. But you can do that in a different database too. So you know, it is more work to have to look in different databases. Depending on your topic, you may still want to just get the database. So what is your checklist?
I don't know.
Where are you?
I don't know right now what I'm doing. I have some ideas, but I don't know.
But within which discipline?
Make
sure I look at
it.
There are different things, and the cool thing is you can find topics. And I will also
and it minimize a lot if you use topics.
So you will still need to have a look at these.
And also,
again, you can set up
In this topic, they have something in the journal.
Because searching is
you don't have to look at
one in the journal.
Yeah.
New things happen all along.
Other thing is like when I'm like trying to set up the papers, I just like always found it so difficult to find like a pre-made copy and paste the citation and import it into like Word.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's like they actually have that on all websites or you just
no,
make
the
yourself.
Things you find in Aurea you can do that with. They have that. You know, most databases do offer some kind of a sent to citation function. That you can just copy and paste. The trouble with that is if you're used to doing that same on one paper, that might work because you have 10, 15, 20, 30 references. But in a master thesis you may have 60, 70, 80 some references. And the trouble then is if you do that manually, you need to also manually maintain what's in the text. So once you delete the paragraph, then you also need to make sure you remove it from the reference, right? Or check whether you also cited the same reference.
At least
for
Word.
In which case you need to maintain it. Right? So that's where EndNote does really good. He talked about using Zotero, so Zotero does the same thing. It doesn't have the full functionality that EndNote does have, but it solves a lot of problems in keeping all the references you want for later, so you can go back and look them up then. But also helps you in the editing.
Sometimes for different now website, sometimes you actually do have to manually make your own citation.
Right.
Which to me seems like taking a baseball bat to the computer and like going, how does it not exist where they don't have it right next to the abstract? It's not like great for copy and paste.
Well, the trouble too is that if you find some references in one database and some in another, and their interpretation of what Harvard looks like, the format for reference,
might be different. So just talking about like one specific paper we're reading off JSTOR, like why is it not automatically some citation already? I can't remember, but just like some databases sometimes it's just like it's either really hard to find
it was like at
UCSD I was doing a lot of JSTOR and IMCB stuff usually.
And
Because I just feel like it's like a function that everybody has to use all the time.
Right.
That's good then.
So if I open this one, let's have a look.
And then you have.
Because it now. So.
Yeah.
Here you can just save the citation or track it or email it.
Yeah.
Right. The trouble is that if you do that from separate sources, then they will all have their interpretations of what that particular format is going to look like. So if you copy and paste from different sources, it's going to look a bit messy. So that's why.
Just because the indentation, or actually have it used separate, like MLA formats.
Both.
Yeah.
Because some allows you to. You know, you can compare that to Aurea. So there's an option. You know, even if it's something you originally found elsewhere, you can just search up that particular paper. But if you look at details here, then there's an option of, you know, this is Norwegian when, is that maybe to English? Okay, so if I look at details, then there's this action that says citation. And it just, here's, I can choose between two different styles. You see, it changes subtly. But even if it here defines which one I can use, this service's interpretation of what Chicago looks like might be slightly different from what another source's interpretation looks like.
Okay.
So
yeah.
It's useful to put them all into one reference into.
Yeah.
I'm coming to that in a minute. Okay.
And so, like, Aurea is UIB, like, library search data catalog, basically?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's integrated both the search cat. Yeah, so you can say that it's a catalog that contains not just the books and reports we have, but even the journals, e-journals, and individual articles within those e-journals. So the disadvantage of the previous system we had was that it couldn't show us which individual articles were available to us. It would only show us which journals. So. But technically it's a joint catalog between all the universities and university colleges in Norway and some independent research institutions such as Institute of Marine Research. So their books are entered in there as well. But in order to access that, you will have to choose the tab that says All Libraries. That will give you a chance to search even their material. Okay. Let's see. Is everybody back? I could be starting again. So here was what I was, what happened when I entered the search of Gasterosteus, and I had these options here of searching, of limiting, but I could also have a look at what happens if I, sorry, that was gone. Search for a database. And you know, I can do some from the front page of the university library, but I could also do some once I'm in Aurea. It says here, find databases. The keyword's biology. And I could have a look at the different databases. Here's ASPA. That for some weird reason shows twice. I don't know why. And the way it's generally set up allows me to, or invites me, to tailor my search so that anything I want to combine with and, I put on separate lines, and things I want to combine with or, I put on the same line. That's the default. And here I can even specify and tell it that I don't just want generation and time, but I want generation time spelled exactly so, with exactly one space between it. So by putting it in quotation marks, I tell it that this is the exact search I want. And I can enter my search. And I have now 20 results. And I can limit them again by publication title, document type, record type, or language, or database. Once I start looking at them, I have information here that might be useful for me. And ASPA gives me often a preview of what's in tables and figures. And one thing that's special for ASPA is that it offers you a chance to search within information that lies in tables. That's very useful, let's say, if you want to look at species composition or something. And you're doing it, you're going through and analyzing, you know, a huge set where there might be very many different species. And you want to have the exact articles that somewhere has your species listed. Because if you just search the text, what happens typically is that if there's more than four or five species, they won't appear as keywords, they won't appear in the abstract, and maybe not even in the full text. So the only place you may see it is if you get access to a full table. Right, so that's useful. So, as we were talking about before, I can click the UPB button and see, okay, is this available? And this apparently is an article that's free of charge. This is an open access article, and that means I have several options to go. For instance, this one, I have full access here, I can open it. And I can, and this is from PLOS One. Remember, I can download the PDF or. Enter a citation, like we were talking about with someone. Okay. Now, another option here, when I scroll down a bit, is that it shows me that here are some other papers, a list of 10 different papers. And where do these come from? Now, if you have ever ordered anything from Amazon, you will be familiar with the function that says people who bought this book also bought. Now this is similar. Instead of buying data, what they have here is click data. So people who have used this system, this is an internationally used system, this is called SFX, that allows you to come from one database to a PDF. And among the people who click the article above, most of them then had, or a lot of them then looked at this paper by Ian Barber, Sticklebacks as Model Hosts in Ecological and Evolutionary Parasitology, and or this one, Age Growth and Reproduction. I don't know why this is connected, it doesn't seem apparently very closely related, but you will probably find that on top you have pretty good data, and further down, the data is poor and poor. What you need to also remember is that it relies on click data. For For a new paper, that means that there's no click data yet. For an older paper, if it's a very obscure paper that not many people have read, there won't be very good click data either. If it's a paper that's very popular, then there will be really good click data. So these suggestions may or may not be good, but they're worth checking out. The other database it's very useful to have a look at is ISA World of Science. There's a couple of things I would like to show you. Is there any questions about ASPA? Or about ISA Web of Science?
Because I cannot follow you when you search on ASPA. But actually, we can do the same thing that we do in my library, right? We can define all the categories and minimize and narrow the range of searching.
Yeah, it's easier to specify exactly how you want the search carried out in ASPA or ISA Web of Science. So they have some advantages over ORIA when it comes to searching for papers. So if I go back here and say I want to find databases, and I search for databases on biology, and I will have a list of the databases relevant to me. I had ASPA here, and it invites me to do a specified search. If I go back to that list, I wanted also to show you Web of Science, because it has some other functionality that I wanted to show. And the default here is a basic search, and I can also tell it I want an advanced search, or I can just enter. When I feel like I need another field, I just add it. For instance, longevity, and I can even add or in here, like so. Now in this case I'm down to 38. And what you need to think about is how many references can you go through. The point here is to expand it, so be sure you're covering everything that's relevant, but at the same time you need also to narrow it down into something that's handleable. And what is handleable differs between people. I know some people who say that, well, you know, anything below 400 is handleable. I would say, well, you know, as you start off, maybe 50, 60 is handleable to go through manual. But anything more than that can be a bit exhaustive. Exhausting, sorry. So 38 is something you can go through, and then next step is to figure out, do you want to screen them here? You have some tools here. For instance, I can open this one and I can say, well, this is not cited, but then again, it's very new, so nobody has had time to cite it yet, right? It shows me the abstract, and it shows me where in the abstract it got the search words from. And here it will show me all the different search words. And it will tell me where the authors are from, funding, etc., etc. A lot of information, you know, which I potentially might want to use to figure out if this is a worthwhile paper to read. Now, if I return to my search, I may want to screen them here and then export them to, say, EndNote or an other referencing tool. Or I may want to immediately export everything and then screen them once they're in EndNote. And either can work. It just depends on what would be an efficient workflow for you. What can you make work? The point here is that Web of Science, ASPA, ORIA, they all offer you information that will help you figure out which papers are good. But on the other hand, as you're sitting here, well, you know, there might be, you know, then suddenly it's lunchtime or somebody calls or it might be time for the next lecture, so you have to walk off and you're interrupted before you're done with the whole thing and then you have to start the search again. So for that reason, it might be good to just export everything into EndNote because then you have it. And then you can work from there and figure out which ones are good or not. Okay, so far about searching. Do you have any more questions about searching? Okay, so as long as you're in Aurea, then it will show you that downloadable either articles or dissertations or anything like that can be accessed when it says full text available. You can press the title, you can press view online or full text, and it will take you there. In this case, the one below, it says that there are two versions. And when it says two versions, it says there's one that's online where you can download the whole thing. You can download the whole thesis. That can be useful. But it also tells you that there's one copy. This is a dissertation. It shows you here that it's available from the Science Library. It's a dissertation from 2011. And if you ask at the desk, we'll show you where the dissertations are. Yeah. Okay. Oh, it's hard to remember to not touch the screen here. But it does also tell you one more thing. It says available. Means it's on the shelf. It should be available for loan right now. If you're in a database, what you'll find is typically, like in ISF Open Science, it will show you one button that says UVB, that's our button, that's University Library Bergen. And then there's another one that says full text from publisher. This full text from publisher might fool you. First of all, in some cases there isn't one, and we still have full text access. Secondly, sometimes it tries to route you through a provider for electronic resources where we don't have a subscription. So you're denied when you're trying to access it. And I tell you, you don't have access, and that too may be wrong. Try instead to use this button, and it will then check with our subscriptions which things you have access to or not. So always go with the UBB button. And when you open it, look something like this, full text available, you just click the full text and look around, and there should be a PDF somewhere. But there's also an option down here to say find, order, print, copy. In this case, this is an electronic copy, it tells you we have. At the moment, we're not actually charging for papers you order from other libraries, but in general, we charge you 60 kroners per article you order from other libraries. However, if you borrow a book, then it's for free. So for that reason, if you want a copy of a chapter from a book, have that book sent, and you can look. First of all, there might be other chapters that are interesting and relevant to you. And secondly, you don't pay 60 kroners for that copy. On the other hand, journal articles or journals that you can't borrow, so those you have to request a copy of. Now, in this case, here's a paper, The Influence of Natural and Anthropogenic Factors on Mangrove Dynamics, etc., etc. This one here is published in Estuarine, Coastal and Shell Science, and here's the cool thing. Now, here's a tab called Order Photocopy, and this is what it looks like. Because all of that information is extracted out, you need to be logged on to our system with the same user ID and password that you use elsewhere at the university. And you will then be allowed to place that order and request a photocopy.
Any questions?
Yep.
Yesterday I logged on the library.
Yeah.
And saw that the book I want that only have the electric version.
Yeah.
But actually I have problem with my eyes when I look at the computer and I want to order the photocopy of two chapters in that book. So I have to do that. Did I have to pay for that copy or?
First of all, if you have an electronic copy, then in most cases you can print it from an electronic copy. So we should look at that. And if that's not available, then in general we charge. But these days, you know, we're in a sort of transition thing. So right now we don't charge if you order it from another library. There may, if you request it, you may want to write specifically, there's a comment field where you can write if you have any specific needs. Mm. Like in this case, you say that due to my eyesight, I cannot read on screen. And that is something that will be taken into account in saying whether we can borrow the book from somewhere else or have it sent, you know, just copies of the chapters you need. Mm. Mm.
So I have to write out to the library.
Yeah, you should do that.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Just a few more things. Okay. I've been talking about searching. And of course there are other methods of coming across relevant papers than just searching. Here's another one. Here's an attempt at illustrating what we call reference tracking, which is where you start out with a paper that you already know about. Then as you're reading that, you make little notes in the reference list of things you want to go on to read next, things that you will be needing to read. That is working your way backwards in time, because by necessity, the things that are listed in the reference list will be older than the paper you're already reading. Next turn, you're reading those papers, things on its reference list will be even older. And seasoned researchers tend to use this a lot. They work their way backwards. And then when they have key papers, they look forwards. Then there are other tools you can use. For instance, Web of Science, where you can look directly at anyone that cited that paper. Or same thing with Google Scholar, where you can look at the people who have cited this paper. You notice underneath it says, this paper is cited by 239, blah, blah, blah. Then you just click those 239 and you get a list of those. And the good thing about that is they can take you all the way up to the research front, the cutting edge of what is happening now, what has just recently been published. So alternating and going back and forth is referred to as reference cycling or reference tracking. Next, you probably will notice that there are a few journals that appear more often within your field of interest. So if you have a look at those on a more or less regular term and see what have they published recently. And you can also order notifications from those journals, either as an RSS feed if you're using that, or as email alerts to say, okay, there's a new issue out of this particular journal, here's the new things, here's a new issue from American Naturalist or the Journal Ecology. Aquaculture. Then of course there's the social network and interacting with people around you. There might be older students, people who are just about to get done. There might be doctorate students or postdocs. But also you may be lucky enough to go to conferences or interact. Also, including with social media. And there's a lot of research blogging going on where people report on what they're doing. Also, there's Twitter that tends to create a lot of, if you follow one or two of important researchers within your own field, then they will tend to send tweets when new interesting papers are out. So it might be worthwhile to follow them. Then there were the automated suggestion services that I mentioned before, the ones that are built into Aurea, for instance. And then I put in the copy. And it's supposed to be symbolic of the things that you cannot determine that you want to find. You know, you can search systematically, but that doesn't mean that you find something. This is supposed to symbolize serendipity, meaning that you go out, you search for something, but what you find may be something completely different. It wasn't what you were looking for, but it might turn out to still be relevant and still be useful for you. And just a reminder to keep your eyes open, because if you focus too tightly on relevance, you may miss out on things that turn out to be quite helpful and useful. Anyway. So, next about citing. Do you have any more questions about how to find relevant literature? Because otherwise I'll move on to citing. So this is what my papers used to look like. So I make a lot of highlights here and there, and then in the reference list I make highlights of the things I want to read next. But why do you cite in the first place? So there's a lot of reasons why citing is a good idea. Well, basically, it's the rules of academia, so it's how things are done. But also, one of the functions is to separate your own contribution from the contribution of other people. So, basically, anything you write in your manuscript where you don't cite anyone, you claim that this is my own thought, this is my own results, because if it weren't, you would be citing someone. So, indirectly, by not citing, you're claiming this is mine. You're talking about the discovery, you don't say who made the discovery, well then you claim that you did, right? This is my idea. So, it's about giving credit to the people who actually carried out work. But it has a lot of functions for the reader, right? So first of all, it has the function of giving enough information about a paper that they might be able to track it down on their own. So they are allowed then to get familiar with the topic, to read up. It also allows them to double check facts. And you'll find that, surprisingly often, if you ask somebody, let's say you ask around the biology department about how often people are cited, and then ask them, well, did they cite you correctly? You'll find that they may not agree that what they're cited on is what they found, necessarily. So it's a very good idea for other people to be able to go, not just trust that what you report about their findings is correct, but that other people can find this paper, read it for themselves, and see, do I interpret it the same way as this other person? Also, any experiment should be described well enough that other people can carry it out and repeat it and see, can I get comparable results? And also it allows people to participate in the debate, the ongoing debate. Then, another function of having a reference list is that it shows other people the extent of your work. Doesn't mean that the longer the reference list, the better the work is. It's about also understanding which references are high quality and could or should be included, and which references should be left out. Also, to show that you include all the key references, you have a sort of basic idea of what this field is about. You've included all the important authors. And lastly, as long as you cite correctly, you don't plagiarize, you're sure that you're not doing any plagiarizing. As I said before, if you fail to give a citation, that's the same thing as claiming that this is mine. But it's entirely possible to do crappy citing and still not plagiarize. But if you cite excellently and cite by all the rules, you're never plagiarizing. So the main point here is to make sure you understand how to cite correctly, then you're fine. And then technically, how do you cite? Well, in humanities, people tend to use direct citations a lot. In biology, that's pretty much reserved for Darwin, right? Where you cite someone's words word by word or verbatim. That hardly ever happens. So what we're left with instead is indirect citations, where you sum up what other people have said, what their results are, and you paraphrase it. The advantage of that, too, is that you can sum up information from two or three or four papers in a paragraph, whereas with direct citations, you have to copy-paste. You know, there's a lot of work in that. It's also harder to read. So, in the text, you have to show who you've cited. In this case, this is a paper from Wollingwu, 1989. This information here in the text should be enough that you can figure out which is the matching reference down here. Here's the full reference. This is the worker queen conflict and fitness consequences in a colony of Bombus hypnorum, etc., etc. Now, the information down here should be enough to allow people to track down the paper. So we need the journal name, the volume, the pages, the year, the author, etc., to double check. One thing you need to make sure is that there's a complete match between citations in the text. Every citation in the text should have a matching entry in the reference list, and vice versa. Every entry here should have a matching reference in the text. And they, of course, can look different. Now, how do you present references? We talk about journal styles. It's basically a format for presenting references. So you can ask your advisor which style they prefer that you use. Some of them prefer that you use a core journal within the field you're covering. Others think it's quite okay if you use some very standard styles, such as Harvard, for assignments and thesis and so on. But ask them what they prefer. But if you look at different styles, you'll find that between styles, the fonts will vary, the sequence of information will vary. Does the year come right after the author, or does it come at the end of the reference? The level of detail varies. For instance, if you look at the journal Science and Nature, they don't even bother to enter the full title of the reference you're looking at. And that might make it a bit harder for you to figure out, do I need to read this paper or not? Then you'll actually have to go look it up. But even within the style, a journal article reference looks different from a book reference, which looks different from a web chapter, from a book chapter, and so on. Now, I have one example here from American Naturalist. Here you see from the introduction, here are two references, and since they're sort of summing up information from two papers, Sikorsky 1998 and Alroy 2008, they're both in the same parentheses. And you also find in this one that, you know, this one's from 1998, this one is from 2008. Within this parenthesis, you can see that the sequence is chronological by year, because Sapolsky comes after Alroy. Depending on which journal style, they could be sorted alphabetically. or you may overrule the whole thing. So, at the end of the paper, you will see that the literature cited, the reference list, will be alphabetical. The other main alternative is what we call the numbered style. And here you see that instead of the parentheses with author and date, you find numbers, 1, 2, reference 1, reference 2. So each citation is assigned a reference number. And this particular reference, like in this case, number 1 is Lubchenco, 1978. And her paper would maintain the same number throughout the whole manuscript. So if you cite her on the last page, she still has reference number 1. So, lastly, referencing tools. I will be giving separate classes in EndNote. We have open EndNote classes. There will be one in September. But also, I think, I haven't really set this up with Magnus and Karin yet, but I think we will offer separate classes for the Bio 300 in EndNote. But all these referencing tools offer you a chance to format your own references. Is there anyone here doing any modeling? Or using LaTeX? As
I've used BibTeX before.
You used BibTeX before. Yeah, you are?
I've also used BibTeX, you know that.
Yes, you have used BibTeX before. But will you be using it now, LaTeX?
No, I don't know yet.
No, you don't know. Okay. Now, because EndNote is not very useful if you're using LaTeX, you can't use it in LaTeX. Anyway, but EndNote has some functions that BibTeX doesn't have. And first of all, as you're searching, you can already download to EndNote your own searchable collection, meaning that you can use that to find the exact paper you need when you need it. This is a useful function above and beyond just the citation. So keeping track of your own papers, knowing which papers you have, knowing which papers you've searched up before, is very useful. Also, it helps you to keep track of your PDFs. I generally say that if you download PDFs, always stick to them, always keep them on your computer. Even if you prefer to read on printouts, then keep the PDF on your computer. It's very useful with EndNote. You can either use the PDFs to extract the references, so you don't have to do a lot of work. Or you can do it the other way around. You have references, and you can have EndNote look up the PDFs for you. Now, it won't find everything, but you know, depending on your field, whether you're doing taxonomy or molecular stuff, if you're doing molecular stuff, I'd say 95% of what you want it can extract. If you're doing, or download, if you're doing taxonomy and papers from 1800, I don't know what, it might be harder. But still, it's very useful. It helps you get the in-text citation, the citation in the actual text, correct? And it helps you to generate a consistent reference list. And it helps to monitor the connection between the citation in the text and the reference list. So if you're doing any heavy editing and you happen to delete a whole paragraph, then it makes sure that the corresponding reference is also deleted from the reference list. Now, if you have any questions later, feel free to contact me in this email address. Remember that there's a chat function on the library pages. You can ask questions there. As I said, I generally offer 3-hour classes, starter classes, and then not. Takes a little while to get into the stuff, get started. But if you want more information on searching and writing in academia, there's also Søk & Skriv, search and write. on this address, and that's available in Norwegian and English. Do you have any questions at this point? In which case, it's lunch. Then it won't fit into everyone's schedule, but we're also offering